Ja, naast talkshows vandaag tijdens Drupal Jam 2021 hebben we natuurlijk ook community sessions met experts uit de community. En we gaan zo direct even kijken en luisteren naar Giuseppe Maggiore van Hoppinger. En Giuseppe die gaat het hebben over structured TypeScript en React applications for headless frontends. Giuseppe Maggiore.
All right. Hello, everyone. Once again, hopefully this time everyone can hear me. I'm Giuseppe Maggiore from Hoppinger, one of the sponsors of this year's Drupal Jam. And today I'm going to talk about TypeScript and React in order to build headless Drupals. Now, as some of you might have noticed already, there are some developments in the market that try to push towards adding more components to our websites in order to make our websites more beautiful and more interactive. And one of those movements has to do with decoupled and headless websites, especially also in the Drupal community. At Hoppinger, we have been using this kind of architecture for many years now, and the basis idea, I'm not going to spend too much time on this given that we only have 20 minutes together today. We set down the CMS, we turn on its API, and then the data about the content is fetched from the Drupal API by a TypeScript and React application. And the TypeScript and React application takes care of the rendering, takes care of the interaction with the user, thereby having the best of both worlds, the powerful content management capabilities of a modern Drupal, together with all the nice frameworks that we have for interacting with the user in TypeScript and React. In this presentation, I'm not assuming any previous knowledge of TypeScript and React. So I'm going to start from the beginning and we'll see how far we come. Now, so here what you see, I just have a very simple application. It doesn't really do anything special whatsoever. It's completely empty, it doesn't even compile yet. You might notice sometimes that on my screen errors are going to appear, like this one that says cannot find name app. That's a TypeScript doing. TypeScript is constantly checking our code to make sure that the variables we're using exist and are used according to their structure. And that's the job of the type checker to make sure, well, that we make less mistakes, and if we do occasionally make a mistake, which is just a normal human nature, this mistake is catched automatically. All right, now let me start by setting up the basic application in React. So in React, one of the ways to define a SOCO, everything is based on components, and components are custom elements of the DOM, like a div or a paragraph or all of these HTML elements. We can build our own, let's say, HTML elements with our own custom logic. And in order to do this, we define a class with the name of the new component we want, and it has to inherit from the React.component. From the React.component base class that has been defined by the people who built React. Now, such a component needs to know two things about our structure. Specifically, what is the input of our new component? In our case, well, that's nothing, and we call this input the properties of the component. And what is the internal state of the component that is used to track information that can change due to user interaction, API calls, timers, and such. And for the state, well, for the moment, let's have no state either. Now, we tell React that our app component has both the app properties and the app state that we just defined. Now we need a constructor. You will notice there is a little bit of a boilerplate code that we have to write, but as we go into the presentation, with a bit of luck, we'll be able to remove a lot of this boilerplate. Now we pass the props along to React itself so that it knows how to initialize them. Now we have to set up the state. The state currently contains no properties, so we just initialize it as an empty thing. And now we can provide a render function, and this render function determines how this component, when React wants to put it on the screen, is actually going to translate it into valid HTML elements plus our own React components. So for now, let's begin and let's follow the ancient tradition of programming introductions by putting a hello world on the screen. Here, there's my webpack should be running and should be compiling automatically. Let's hope that this is the case. And, oh, well, let me open the browser. Yeah, I apologize. On this machine, I actually use Edge. I'm a Chrome user, but on this machine, not today. Oh, okay. Webpack seems to be falling asleep. So let's give it another hit. All right. Now. So, well, while Webpack starts back up, the interesting thing to keep into account is therefore that in React, a component in the frontend has these three very important things. The properties, that is whatever input has come into this component, its state that can therefore change, so the state is mutable, whereas the properties are given from outside and cannot be changed, and the renderer, which turns the component into something that we put on the screen. So the translation of the component into, well, valid HTML. Now, let's refresh this. Well, it wouldn't be a live coding demo if everything just went all right at the first go. Well, the application seems to be alive. The ports are being forwarded. Let me hammer it once again. Oh, so 5000 SPA. Come on. Oh, and it's still, okay, that's not exactly what was supposed to happen. Oh, how silly. I was editing the wrong file, my apologies. Well, no wonder. Okay, let me change to the index file. Okay, now, sorry, everything that I've written should have been written in the right file that React was actually going to read from. And there you go, we have the hello world. Okay, I have to say, just a minor note, I've been doing presentations for about a decade now, and I don't think I've done a single one of the multiple hundreds that this just went smooth all the time. So just learn to cope with the growing sense of dread of what's happening now, and you keep soldiering on. Okay, and here you can see that React is correctly taking our custom component and it's drawing that to the screen. Excellent. Now, let's add a little bit of functionality, because one of the core aspects of React is its ability to manage state and to perform actual operations. Let's put in our state, well, let's do something really trivial. I hope you'll forgive it in the context of, well, this being a very simple introduction to React. Let's define our app state as something that simply counts the number of some interactions. So we just track a counter. It's just going to be a number. And you can imagine that if we can track a counter, it doesn't matter how complex the information gets. If we can track the changes to a counter, well, we can track anything else. Let me also start our attempt to keep the logic of the state and the logic of the React application a little bit separate. So I define here an initial app state, and, well, as you can imagine, the counter starts up at zero, because if we want to have a counter that increases or decreases based on user interactions, well, we want to clearly start at zero. So this way we don't have to put the initial app state here in line. We just call this, well, we just initialize this this initial app state variable, and we can reuse it in order to keep our component a little bit more focused on just the React part instead of the state management. Okay, now let's also add a button, and let's say that the button simply does, well, plus one, so it just increases our counter, and when we click on the button, okay, now this is the interesting thing about React. I can't really here say that the state dot count will become this.state.count plus one. And why is this not the case? Because React really wants us to notify the component when we want to create a new state, because that new state might be used by the renderer, and so React must know, okay, you've changed the state, so now you want to re-render. Okay, so what we get is a neat little function that is setState. So this setState function is literally what React provides us. And the setState function takes a new state. Now, this new state will be, well, a copy of the state. Now, right now, we only have the count, the CNT field inside the state, but you can imagine that clearly there might be other stuff that we are not touching, so we might just want to carry that with us. So this syntax here simply means make a copy of the state, and the curly brackets simply instantiate an object in TypeScript, in JavaScript / TypeScript. But then we say make a copy of the state, but for an exception. CNT becomes this dot state dot CNT plus one. Okay, now let's also make sure that we can actually show this value on the screen. So let's say that the counter is, and then here we put this dot state. And now we can actually see the feedback, the visual feedback, if you will, of our counter updating and the value of the counter. Now. Oh, well, counter is this dot state dot CNT. Well, let's see if it was actually throwing an error, because it does. Yes, absolutely. So React doesn't really like it when we put a whole object like the state in the DOM. So it's actually going to refuse that and give an error. That's the reason why we can't see anything. Whereas a number or a string is capable of dealing with it. Okay. Oh, now, by the way, I should have probably said this. I have no feel for design whatsoever. So the application is not going to look anywhere near pretty at any time during the presentation, I think. Well, sometimes you have to grab the bull by the horns. Well, I do have Bootstrap, so at least I can leverage, I didn't say it was going to be beautiful, but at least now the button is styled in Bootstrap. And well, let's also put a counter container instead of just a flat div, and then at least we leverage a tiny bit of React Bootstrap. And these components are also custom components built by the React Bootstrap community. Okay, at least it's slightly better aligned. And if I press plus one, lo and behold, the counter goes up. And now we can even extend this, and the counter can go up and down as well. All right, so let's also put a button group. And here you also get a glimpse. Now, all of these things, like the button group, and the container, all come from another React another React framework, which is React Bootstrap, which simply provides a series of HTML-looking elements, such as indeed that don't exist in actual HTML, which are simply React components, very much like the app component that we have already worked on. So now we can increase the counter, we can decrease the counter, and there we go. All right. Now, in order to try to keep our application neat according to the principle of separation of concerns, which is something that is quite important, because these applications, don't underestimate them. They grow really fast. As your front end grows and you get feedback from users and designers and your own feedback, they will become gigantic. So the ability to split things so that they stay manageable is perhaps even, it is getting more and more important. So a little bit of software engineering is something I love to show. So let's add a function in order to update the state of our counter, so that the render function here doesn't need to be bothered with too much domain specific logic and can just be focused on how do we draw our little app component. Okay, so let's say that we have the app state updaters. This is a pattern I really like, so I actually just define a structure that contains these updaters. And in the app state updaters, I want to have increment. And what does increment do? Now, actually, increment, it needs to know the current value of the state. So let's say it takes as input the current state, which is, well, unsurprisingly, an app state, and it's supposed to return a new app state. And this new app state will be, well, exactly the same as what we have here, minus one little detail, that instead of this dot state, clearly we get current state. And here we also get current state dot count plus one. And also, well, we don't just have incre, we also have decre. And as you can imagine, decre simply decrements instead of incrementing. And one of the neat side effects of this is that set state can simply now accept the app state updaters dot incre and app state updaters dot decre callbacks. Let's save this, compile. Yes, it's alive. And let's see what happens. And okay, it works. And you might be wondering at this point, okay, but this is not exactly the same code we had before, because Inker is now a function that takes its input state and gives you a new state. It's not the resulting state. And the very interesting thing about React is that the setState function also not only just accepts the new state, that you can say, hey, here's the new state, to do whatever you need to do with it. You can also give it a function that knows how to update the current state, and then React will provide that state later on. And this actually happens to be a preferred pattern, because it doesn't force you to commit to, hey, this is the new state, but you just tell React, this is how to update the state, which can be very, very handy when dealing with concurrency. All right, now, as we have here, so what we would typically do in a real life scenario is we would probably put all these things, like the app state and the initial app state and the app state updaters, this would go in a file like the app state .ts, and then the component could go into app state .tsx, so sorry, app, app component. And as you can imagine even further, perhaps you could even split the render functionality and the calls to set state, so the definition of the state, in yet another layer, which some people call a layout file, in order to separate the state logic, the state updaters, the component itself, and the way the component looks like on the screen, so the layout, in order to be able to live with, to have a separate lifecycle for all of these aspects of your application, and to keep it maintainable so that you can have it grow without the pain of maintaining it growing correspondingly. Now, I guess we're getting close to the allotted time for this short introduction. We have touched a little bit of the basics of TypeScript and React. There is a lot more to discover, but if you stick to this kind of pattern, you will have a lot of pleasure from this kind of framework, and you will be able to build awesome applications, which is something I wish you strongly for the rest of your professional career. Thank you very much for the attention, and I guess this is it. See you next time.